Do you know, self-reflection is the single most important thing required for our growth. Self-reflection allows you to grow your understanding of who you are, what your values are, and why you think and act the way you are. It is a self-analysis that allows you to bring into alignment what you wish to be. Self-reflection gives the brain an opportunity to pause amidst the chaos of life, to untangle through the observations and experiences. It allows your brain to consider various interpretations and create a meaning out of them. And this meaning becomes your learning, which then transforms your mindset and your future actions. In our ancient scriptures, three key elements have been prescribed in the practice of self-realization and self-reflection. And these three elements are, first is tapas or self-discipline. Second is swadhyaya or self-study or self-reflection. And third is Ishwar Pranidhana, that is surrender to the divine consciousness. There are three key aspects of our personality which need to be trained. Tapas or self-discipline helps in training of the willpower. Swadhyaya trains our intellect, while Ishwar Pranidhana, it trains the emotions. So it requires tremendous will to practice tapas. It requires a great intellectual capacity to do swadhyaya and find meaning from the scriptures. And it requires great inner emotional purity to love God, to surrender to God, which is Ishwar Pranidhana. So today in this video, we shall be going very, very deep into the aspect of swadhyaya. So stay on with us till the end. And if you have not subscribed till now, I suggest you to subscribe to this channel now so that you do not miss out on the forthcoming videos in this series. Before we proceed, kindly allow me to pay my gratitude to my Guru. Om Hrom Shri Kanhaiya Lal Sharmaye Namaha. Om Shri Gurve Namaha. Maharishi Patanjali says in his Yoga Sutras, Swadhyayat Isht Devta Samprayogaha. That means self-reflection or swadhyaya leads to pure connection or communion, samprayogaha, with one's spiritual deity or Isht Devta. In fact, swadhyaya is so important for self-development that this word is mentioned in many places in Yoga Sutras as well as in Bhagavad Gita. Maharishi Patanjali mentions swadhyaya as one of the five observances or niyamas, along with saucha or purity, santosha or contentment, tapas meaning self-discipline, and Ishwar Pranidhana, that is self-surrender, surrender to the divine consciousness. The five niyamas together with the five yamas have been described as the 10 commandments of the Sankhya Yoga. The practice of swadhyaya as a niyam is performed in many forms. See, one form of swadhyaya is mantra meditation, which anchors our mind to one thought. So this practice prevents the mind to wander. It silences the noise of thought, and it ultimately leads to inner resonance. Another form of swadhyaya is reading spiritual scriptures that absorbs the person to a state of trance and a unifying oneness. By swadhyaya, there is Isht Devta Samprayogaha, says the sutra. That means there is union of oneself with the deity of our worship. There is an inner alignment with the character of the deity. You know, whatever we think in our mind, we become that and we get that. But this thinking should not be a shallow thinking. It should be a very deep absorption of oneself. The whole of us should be filled with longing for our deity, which is in our mind. There should be no other thought except the qualities, except the character and the nature of our deity. Anything and everything can be obtained in this world if only there is a will behind it. If the force of thought is intense enough, there is nothing which is impossible. This is the point made out in this sutra. Yet another form of swadhyaya is the process of self-reflection, where one reflects on one's own behaviors and one's own inner motivations and the voices in the head. And this self-reflection is not merely contemplation of our own motives and behaviors, but also of our circumstances and the environment that we are in. What is the direction our life is taking on, and what desirable changes can lead us to a more fulfilling self? Lao Tzu has said, knowing others is intelligence, knowing yourself is true wisdom. Mastering others is strength, but mastering yourself is true power. We are, at the core, divine consciousness. And around this pure consciousness, we are packed in boxes of our experiences, our conditioning, and our belief systems. But owing to ignorance about our true nature or avidya, we identify ourselves as these boxes. We identify ourselves with our likes and with our dislikes, our fears and our imagination. The root cause of our suffering is only that we forget who we truly are. We mistakenly believe that we are these boxes we are wrapped in, and forget that we are really the divine essence hiding inside those boxes. So swadhyaya, or self-study, is about knowing our true identity as the divine being. And this process of knowing ourselves and knowing about the boxes that we are wrapped in creates a pathway of true liberation. We can find the nature of our boxes by watching our projections, by looking at our belief system. The ability to shift our identification from our ego self, that is our boxes, to the witness within us, and finally to discover our true identity as divine consciousness itself, is the purpose of this self-reflection. Every thought that you think about the world, every thought you have about another person, about the circumstances of your life, is just a projection of your own self, and it reveals the nature of your interior boxes. Lord Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Anudveg karam vakyam satyam priyahitam chayata swadhyaya abhyasanam chayav vangmayam tap uchyate. That is, words that do not cause distress, words that are truthful, that are inoffensive, that are beneficial, as well as swadhyaya, that is the regular study of our spiritual scriptures, these are declared as the austerity of speech. The world is simply a reflection of what we see, not what is there. The world is only a mirror that shows us the picture of ourselves. We cannot love or hate something about another person unless it is already there within us first. You can try experimenting with this truth by changing the way you see, and you will notice the world will change to fit the story that you are telling. As you begin to reflect in and you start paying attention to what you say to yourself, about yourself, what you say about the other person, and what you say about your life, you will get a clue about these boxes you have been wrapped inside that create your own life universe. We only tend to notice our beliefs and our conditioning when there is a kind of some turmoil in our lives. It is in these times of turmoil we may get an opportunity to trace back our reactions to a negative belief which we may be holding consciously or unconsciously. So tracing any turmoil back to ourselves will help us unpack the boxes that we have wrapped ourselves in. We feel happy when people or circumstances conform to what we believe that is right, but we get disturbed when people and circumstances are not as what we want them to be. We forget that it's not those people and circumstances that are the cause of our disturbance. It is our model of reality that determines our happiness or suffering. We foolishly fight with all our energy to justify our beliefs rather than unpack the boxes that we are contained in. You know, just like a gift waiting to be opened, every event that life presents to us is a precious opportunity to learn the truth about the boxes that we have packaged ourselves in. Anthony DiMello puts it like this: every time I am disturbed, there is something wrong within me. I am not prepared for what has come. I am out of tune with things. I am resisting something. If I can find out what that something is, it will open the way to spiritual advances. So we need to keep our eyes and our hearts wide open to look at every ripple of discomfort that we experience. And Swadhyaya beautifully illustrates the reality of what sits inside of us. If we can just start witnessing the play being unfolded in our lives, we will have the ability to step outside of our ego consciousness. We can discover that we are the spark of the same divine consciousness, and then our ego becomes a function of the soul rather than a function of itself. Swami Veda writes, "It is by surrendering the limitation of its own banks that a river becomes the mighty ocean." Do not be afraid to throw away the trinkets of your ego to gain the diamond of grace. But this process begins only when we start growing our ability to witness. With this power of being a witness, to distance ourselves from ourselves, we will begin to see how we have made up our own boxes, our own realities. And then our false belief system begins to crumble down and loses its power over us. To be a witness is our ability to watch ourselves act and respond. It is our ability to watch our thoughts and our emotional turmoils. It allows us to know our true self and the stories that run within us. The witness is our ability to wash the ego rather than identify with it. The profoundness of this witnessing is that we begin to know ourselves as something different than we thought we were. It is this ability to witness that begins to heal our lives. Knowing that we aren't who we thought we were begins to open up the possibility of knowing our true self. You know, our minds are like that river carrying things in it. The river carries lot of pollutants, but the river itself is pure. If we identify with what our mind is carrying, our thoughts, our stories, our beliefs, then we start identifying ourselves with those things. But when we identify with the divine within us, which is the pure river, and merely watch the thoughts float by, we will realize that we are simply carrying the thoughts and those stories and those beliefs. They are not who we are. Meditation is a very important aspect of self-reflection. It is a place where we start witnessing, we start recognizing our belief systems and start shifting our identity from being a box to being divinity within. And as we start shifting our attention to the divinity within, the boxes of belief systems, they begin to crumble away and we become free. So write in the comments below which form of Swadhyaya you wish to follow and which will be your commitment to yourself to transform your life forever from an ordinary life to an extraordinary life. And if you wish to learn more secrets to live an extraordinary life, you join my free workshop whose link is given below. And in my free workshop, I tell you the secrets to design your extraordinary life. And I am your brother guide to prosperity. And my mission is to help you realize the dreams of your life and help you achieve something worthwhile in life for which your family, your parents, and your children can be proud of.